Hello. In this video, we'll look at two different projects for running data science notebooks like Jupyter. Both of these environments are cloud-based from Google, but they can be quite different in terms of their setup and usage. One is Google Colab, and the other is Vertex AI, specifically the Workbench service. Now, while Google Colab is often talked about within the context of academia and researchers, and Vertex AI Workbench is most typically understood through the context of enterprise business environments, it's a bit of an oversimplification to say that individuals should be using Colab and businesses should be using Vertex AI Workbench. We'll look at specific similarities and differences between these environments so you can make a more informed and nuanced decision about which project to use. Let's jump into the Google Cloud Console to walk through Vertex AI Workbench a bit. This is a brand new project, and so we'll go to the Vertex AI page and enable the recommended APIs. Once the API is enabled, we'll go to the Workbench tool and create a user-managed notebook. From this interface, you can tell one of the advantages of Vertex AI Workbench is that it includes a really wide variety of pre-configured notebooks for certain Python and machine learning tasks. Just for simplicity, we'll use a plain Vertex AI Python 3 notebook, but let's go to the advanced options to see some additional configurability. Right off the bat, we'll see another important difference, which is that there's a much larger price associated with these Vertex AI Workbench notebooks compared to Google Colab. That does come with some additional environment flexibility, though, and configurability of machine sizes and accelerators, for example, with CPU and RAM. We'll leave the defaults here, including for the machine type, which gives us 4 CPUs and 16 gigabytes of RAM. We do have an option for some machine types and regions to add GPUs to our environment. We have some really nice control over disk sizes, and this can actually be a bit of a differentiator if you're using really large datasets. It can be nice to have a machine that just has a couple of terabytes worth of storage disks attached to it, so you don't have to do any complicated batching or download/upload tasks to manage that large dataset. This is also a differentiator. We're actually running this notebook on our Google Cloud environment and a VM that's automatically provisioned for us. The VM is going to be visible in the console, and we'll see that in just a moment, so that gives us some really pretty low-level configurability. We can have, for example, this VM in a similar subnet as other software systems that we're running, or have our notebook easily access internal API endpoints when we're using Vertex AI Workbench. The IAM security here is important as well, where we have the availability to use service accounts or users. Oftentimes we'll want to use either the compute engine service account or a custom service account for our notebooks. This allows us to easily and in a no-code way integrate with other services like, for example, Google Cloud Storage, SQL databases, or even some of the other Vertex AI services like Vertex AI Pipelines. We'll add a link in the description to a previous video that we did on setting up Jupyter notebooks on Vertex AI Workbench. With the details largely walked through, let's go ahead and create this notebook. Now, it is going to take a couple of minutes for this notebook to finish provisioning, so let's go ahead and go into the Colab side of things to see how that setup looks. When we go to colab.research.google.com, we're already in this sort of Jupyter-like environment for running code. We can sign in to start executing code and can now create a new notebook, for example. We do have some pre-configurations as far as libraries in the runtime here. If we look to compare to our Vertex AI system, we have a little bit less RAM and certainly less disk space. We can see here that we can actually increase that memory and disk space by upgrading to Colab Pro, which is about $10 a month. Even with this free environment, though, we can change the runtime type and use things like GPUs. For example, we can attach a T4 GPU to our notebook here. Now we can see some GPU RAM tracking. While Colab is certainly going to be cheaper, there is much less configurability for the Colab environment as compared to the Vertex AI Notebooks environment. Let's look at some low-level backend views to understand even more about this dimension of configurability. If we go into the compute engine, we can see the instance that we are running in the Vertex AI Workbench and see all the details around this. We can even SSH into this machine itself to be able to do some system-level installations or other custom tasks. Whether through the SSH or through the notebook itself, we also have the ability to access a terminal. I will open up the Jupyter notebook to show this concept, and we'll open a terminal here. As you can see from this note, you can only get access to a terminal using the Colab Pro subscription, which is at $10 per month US for your notebooks. Let's look at some integration concepts across these two environments. Conceptually, Vertex AI Workbench, as we've alluded to earlier, is going to integrate really nicely with the Google Cloud platform and all the hundreds of services that are in it. That said, if we look at the more consumer-type offerings such as Gmail and the other services contained in Google Workspace, that integration is going to be much tougher with Vertex AI Workbench. This assumes you're in an enterprise ecosystem and using things like storage in Google Cloud Platform, that is, cloud storage, instead of the more consumer-oriented Google Drive for things like your data science datasets. So that will integrate really nicely. We can actually demonstrate this in the code in the two notebooks here. In our Vertex AI Workbench notebook, for example, let's run a gsutil command to see what buckets are in this project. With no configuration, we're able to access services as defined by the service account that we used to provision for this notebook. We can, for example, list and get objects in this Google Cloud Storage bucket based on the permissions that we've assigned with that service account, which, in this case, is the default Compute Engine service account. If, however, we wanted to access Google Drive files, it's going to be very challenging from this Jupyter environment. We would need to do things like setting up OAuth credentials and API access mechanisms, and then consume those with additional libraries and code on the Google Cloud site, ultimately leading to a very complex and challenging setup. We can, however, very easily access Google Drive on the more consumer-oriented Google Colab side. For example, if I put in a cell here to import the Drive package from the Google Colab library and then mount that drive, we'll get a little interface to confirm the connection. And then, back in our Colab, we'll have a mounted directory with our Google Drive files. This works really seamlessly, largely because we're using the same identity in this Colab, that is, we're using our demo user, and it's in the same software suite. This Colab system is really closer to Workspace than it is Google Cloud in a lot of ways. So I can, for example, look at the now mounted drive folder and see my drive and my shared drives. Next up, let's focus on the multi-user aspect of these notebooks. In Google Cloud, this workbench will show up for anybody that has permissions to see it, and they can access this Jupyter Lab instance and potentially run code or data engineering pipelines in this notebook directly. Meanwhile, the Colab environment allows you to share notebooks, but fundamentally, the execution of those notebooks is really tied to the user as opposed to the organization or the group. This makes sharing code pretty easy on both sides, but the sharing of execution is certainly going to shine in the Jupyter environment since folks can jump into the exact same Jupyter instance. This difference in execution also extends to the ability to run background execution jobs. If you close your browser on the Colab side, that's going to stop the execution. So, unless you're using Colab Pro Plus, you'll have to maintain that browser tab in your notebook environment to get the code to run. On the other hand, while Jupyter Lab is running on a VM in its own instance, it's going to continue executing regardless of how much you're monitoring or viewing that notebook. Let's finish by looking at the getting started experience. While we highlighted in the Google Cloud site that there were some steps involved and a bit of a learning curve in setting up this notebook, the getting started process is even more extensive. To start provisioning these notebooks, you need to have a Google Cloud project, typically with some foundations and numerous standard cloud prerequisites. You'll probably want to set up identity structures, resource organization for your projects and folders, billing, and some form of networking and security. Meanwhile, with Colab, as you saw earlier, we just go to colab.research.google.com and we're ready to roll. This can be done with any Google account, so it's much quicker to get started on the Colab side. With that, we hope we've highlighted some important similarities and differences between these two powerful ways to run your Jupyter environments. Both are battle-tested, scalable, and powerful, qualities that you can only get by running your notebooks in the cloud. In many ways, you can't go wrong with either option. That said, there are some important considerations, especially around who you're working with on these projects, if you're working with anyone, and what kind of controls and flexibility you need around these environments. These factors will really dictate your choice here. With that, I'd like to thank you for watching and note that we'll keep an eye on the comment section for any questions. Thank you.